What is going on, friends? In this video, I'm going to explain 5 advanced concepts that I believe every Python developer should know. Understanding these concepts can take you from an intermediate developer to an expert. Without any delay, let's get started. First on my list is generators. You use a generator when you need to process a large dataset. Storing a large dataset in memory all at once could cause the application to crash due to insufficient memory. So what you want to do is to request data only when it is needed, rather than loading the entire dataset into memory. Generators are a special type of function where the yield keyword is used. Whenever you want to retrieve an item from a generator, the function body is executed until it encounters the yield keyword. At that point, the value after the yield keyword is sent to the caller. The next time you want to retrieve a value, the execution resumes from where it paused. A generator in Python continues to yield values until there are no values to produce. Let's call this generator gen equals generate infinite sequence point type of gen. Let's run the program to see the type. As you can see, the type of gen is a generator. We can always retrieve the next item by using the next function. Print next of gen. Print next of gen. Now let's run the program 01. Check out this video where we use generators to efficiently process a large dataset. Next on my list is iterators. An iterator is any Python object that implements these 2 special methods, next and iter. You can use the next function to return the next element in an iterator because the special next method has been implemented. The iter function turns an object into an iterator. Let's create an instance of the range iterator class. My range equals range iterator, we need to pass the start and the end, 5. An instance of a class is also known as an object. So we can use the next function on this object because this special next method has been implemented. Next of my range, let's print this on the screen, print. Now let's run the program to see the outputs. The first element returned is 2. Let's try it out again. The next element after 2 is 3. As I mentioned, the iter function turns an iterable object into an iterator. Let's make use of the iter function. Let's create an iterable. My list equals a list data type 1, 2. Then we want to use the iter function to turn this iterable into an iterator. My list. Let's say iterator equals this. Let's use the type function to know the type of this object. Print type of iterator. Now let's run the program. As you can see, the type of this object is list iterator. We can also change the list to a string ABC. Let's check the type of the object, string iterator. Now we want to use the next function to retrieve the next element in the iterator. So let's make use of the next function, print next of iterator. Now let's execute the program. 1, 2. The first element is 1 and the second element is 2. When there are no more elements to retrieve from the iterator, it raises a stop iteration error. Let's call next again. Now let's run the program. Stop iteration. Context managers allow you to automatically handle the setup and teardown phases when dealing with external resources. For instance, if you want to operate on a file, 3 steps are involved. Open the file, read from or write to the file, close the file. The issue with this approach is that if an error occurs before reaching this line, the file remains open. One approach to solve this issue is to open the file inside a try except block. So So if any error occurs, we can be sure that the file will be closed because the finally block will always run. A cleaner and more memory efficient approach is to use a context manager by using the with keyword. So we are going to write with open some file as file. Then we want to write into the file. These two lines of code are equivalent and cleaner than what we wrote before. Before you can use an object with the with keyword, the object must implement these two special methods, __enter and __exit. The open function returns text IO based objects. Text IO based inherits from IO based, which is a context manager. That's why we are able to use the with keyword with the open function. Here is a custom implementation of the open function. The enter method is called immediately when the execution flow enters the with block. This method is responsible for acquiring any resources that the context manager needs. The value returned by the enter method is assigned to the variable specified after the as keyword, which is this file object. In this case, the value of file object is what is returned by enter. That's why we can call all methods applicable to files on the file object. The exit method is called immediately when the execution flow leaves the with block. That means this method is called when we exit out of the with block. Let's say the file name is test.txt. So let's run the program. Entering the context, file closed in exit. A new file has been created and the content is hello. Moving on, we have decorators. A decorator is a function that takes another function as an argument with the sole purpose of extending or decorating it. It acts as a wrapper that provides additional functionality to an existing function. The function we passed to the greet decorator is used within the wrapper. We call the function passed to the decorator and add extra features to it. Now let's see how we can make use of the decorator. To use the greet decorator, we need to pass a function to it. So let's pass greet to it, greet. This initial greet function does not know how to greet. It only calls out the name of the person. When you call greet decorator, what is actually returned is the wrapper, which is the inner function. So it makes sense to assign the result of greet decorator call to a variable like inner or wrapper. Let's call it inner. Remember that inner, which is what is returned, is a function. So we can call inner. And when we want to call inner, which is this wrapper function, we need to pass an argument, which is the name. Let's say Ray. Let's assign the returned value to a new variable, print x. Now let's run the program. Hi Ray. As you can see, we've successfully decorated the initial greet function. Python provides an easier approach by using the at symbol. To decorate a function, place the at symbol above the function definition, followed by the name of the decorator, greet decorator. This is an alternative to manually passing a function to another function. Now let's call the greet function x equals greet and the name is readOn. Let's run the program again. Hi readOn. There is so much we can achieve with decorators. I have a complete video where we dive deeper into various use cases. Check out the link below to watch it. Next on my list is asynchronous programming. Asynchronous programming executes one step at a time. The program moves on to the next step only after the current step is complete. In essence, the next step will not run until the current step is complete. An asynchronous program also processes one step at a time. It does not necessarily wait for an execution step to be completed before moving on to the next one. This means that the program can continue to future execution steps even if a previous step hasn't yet finished. Any function defined with the async keyword is a coroutine. The await keyword suspends the execution of the read data coroutine until db.fetch completes and returns the data. Let me use this example to illustrate how asynchronous programming works. In an asynchronous program, As soon as the await keyword is encountered, control is released back to the event loop so that other asynchronous tasks can run. We are using asyncio.sleep to simulate a non-blocking operation that takes a long time to complete. While waiting for this part to return a result, other parts of the program are allowed to run. The nice part about asynchronous programming is that as soon as the result is returned from the operation, the program is notified and code execution resumes right after the await statement. The key is that the program is allowed to perform other tasks while waiting for 4 seconds. The expected result when we run this program is that task 1 starting is printed to the screen. While waiting for this part to complete, other tasks are allowed to run. This means task 2 starting is printed next. Now let's run the program to see what happens. Task 1 starting, task 2 starting. I hope you've learned something in this video. Thanks for watching. Subscribe, like, and comment.